Very good. Okay. We're ready. Yeah, I want to take you back 2,000 years ago to that point where Jesus was, he was growing up and he was feeling inside his heart that he had a destiny. And we now know that that destiny is all of our destinies. This is a destiny that we share to know God, to know our source and our creator. And yet he had to practice his prayers, his faith, and he also had to practice patience to wait on his time and know that when his time came, he would open up and he would begin to extend the presence that he became fully aware of. So for each of us, this is the same process that we go through. We seem to come to this world, we grow and mature from childhood into our teenage years and our adulthood, and there can be mystical experiences along the way that we've shared, peak experiences. We get glimmers and glimpses that the world is not what it seems to be, and that there is something greater. There's a greater purpose for our life than what we've learned in the past. Greater purpose than our education, greater purpose than our skill levels. It's as if we have developed a personality and skill levels in an egoic framework, but without knowing what they're for. And then when we start to get activated in our heart, we start to realize, wow, there is a purpose for everything that I seem to develop in the ego's sense. And I know I shared a bit of my journey yesterday, and I was sharing how I had 10 years of university full-time. I developed a lot of skills during those 10 years, and yet I didn't know what they were for. So it was quite curious to keep on developing and sharpening the skills, but with this very strong feeling like I can't see how these will be used. I can't see myself plugging into a career or into a lifestyle that is based on these skills and based on my limited perception. And the truth is that none of us can. That's why when we go into the journey with the Spirit, as I shared last night, that miracles are involuntary and should not be under conscious control. But most of everything we've developed in our life is to take charge of our life, to carve out our niche, to specialize, to become educated, to become a fully functioning human being. And yet there's something inside of us that says there's so much more. There's so much more that you're unaware of. Even quantum physicists have talked about this, and many people in many spiritual traditions, that we seem to just perceive the smallest little fraction of what we're capable of perceiving. In Course in Miracles terms, we're just perceiving through the ego, through the lens of the ego, and we're looking through the five senses, and we're seeing a very limited, distorted perception. As it said in the Bible, in Corinthians, we're looking through a darkened glass. And this darkened glass becomes accepted as normal. It becomes accepted as just the way it is, even though it's so dark and so distorted that Jesus is telling us constantly, if you only knew what lies beyond this darkened glass, you would be in a state of wonder. You would be in a state of euphoria. You would be in a state of extreme exuberant joy and supreme happiness if you could look beyond this limited lens of the ego. There's even two lessons, workbook lessons 163 and 167 in the workbook of A Course in Miracles, which Jesus gives like a dissertation on death. And he's talking about the ego being death. He's not talking about physical death. He's saying, if you believe in the ego, you do believe in death. And it has blocked you from knowing eternal life. And he goes on to define it, and he says that even a little sigh of weariness is death. He goes on to say that any experience you have that is not supremely happy, supreme happiness, anything at all, including a little sigh of weariness, it is death. If it's not supreme happiness, then you are believing in and addicted to death. And death blocks the eternal nature of Christ and the eternal nature of the Creator, of God. So there's another part in the Course where Jesus says, you have no idea in this world of how much your Father loves you. So what we've seen as family love or romantic love or love of our pets, us toward them and them towards us, or other forms of love, we go deeper into the Course and Jesus is teaching us, no, you really don't know how vast this love is. This love, it would, in fact, in the Forgotten Song, he says, you would weep if you remembered all those that you loved and how much you were loved. And he's referring to heaven. You would weep, your tear ducts would just open and the tears would just burst out of your eyes if you had the slightest inkling of how much God loves us. So we're going to use two episodes today to try to move towards opening our hearts up to give and receive that love. And some of you have noticed that the little sign we have up there for the life of mysticism has two children in a field of flowers. And that's the beautiful thing of going to this experience of this divine innocence. In the Bible, Jesus was quoted as saying, except you become as little children, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And he goes on to explain it to us in the Course, saying that infants are completely dependent on their parents for their survival. And what he meant by except you become as little children, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven, is he said you have to become that dependent on the Holy Spirit, as dependent as infants are with their parents. And we talked a bit about that yesterday. There is no such thing as intellectual understanding. You can't intellectually grasp the Course. It's just another construct. That the Course is a course based on application and on action. It's like taking actions based on guidance and really letting Jesus guide the action component of the miracle. He will tell you where to bestow the miracles, with whom to bestow the miracles, and it has to come from the Spirit. As I said yesterday, Jesus is the only one, he says in the Course, that can perform miracles indiscriminately. And because he can do that, he can lead that direction of following the prompts of Jesus and letting Jesus direct the way leads to the experience of revelation, which is direct contact with the light, a direct experience of the light. When I read those words, those aren't just words for me because After I immerse myself so deeply in the course for about 8 hours a day, then that preceded these like cascading miracles is the only way I can describe it, where everything started to feel very surreal. And then I had the three revelatory experiences. So that was Jesus took me into the light through my willingness to let the miracles come through me, to not try to control who I would speak to, where I would go. And it took a lot of willingness to just loosen up and let go of all the plans and the images generated from the past that were part of David's idea of what would be nice to do in the future. It was like, once I handed over the steering wheel, I handed over the reins, then I was able to be led into these revelatory experiences. Today, what we're going to do is the first episode we will look at will be an episode from season number one, where Jesus is just about ready to go on his public mission with the apostles. And it's a beautiful scene because the Holy Spirit always takes us in gradually and helps us build our confidence and kind of let it pour through us in a smooth, relaxed way. So we are confident in the Spirit coming through us. And this particular episode has Jesus before he's gone on his public mission, and he's just camping. He has a little tent, he has a little fireplace. He's just off having a very devoted camping time with God, doing his prayers, and he's just so connected, but he's collecting wood for the fire. He's preparing, doing some of his wood handicrafts that he had done as a carpenter. Very simple things. He hasn't gone on a public teaching mission yet, but his camping site will be discovered by a girl who comes there and is so excited with what she sees. She's hiding and watching, looking at the site and watching, and then she goes and gets a friend, and then they go and get their friends. So we have Jesus and a group of children. What a beautiful thing to observe, because little children oftentimes are so receptive and they're so curious, and they have not formed a lot of hard line perceptions and judgments yet. They're still quite open. And to me, this is a beautiful symbol of how the Spirit takes us slowly into our function of extending this love and light. Slowly we're shown where we can bestow our light, where we can offer a gift. It has to be under the direction of the Spirit. It can't be based on past learning and past preferences. It can't be based on judgments of any kind. You can't really have a thought and say, wow, this one really needs this or this one needs that, because that's not the way that it works. It's for one's own mind to extend the light. And Jesus knows where there is a receptivity. We have to speak, as Kirsten talked about on Friday, you have to speak to those where there is a receptivity, where you have a mighty companion who wants to hear it as much as you want to share it. And that's an orchestration by the Holy Spirit. You can't just go out like trying to give your miracles away like you have a machine gun and you're just going to try to unload your miracles as fast as you can, wherever you can, because again, only Jesus, because he's completed his part in accepting the atonement, is capable of sharing miracles indiscriminately, because he is the light. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is able to extend in any way, but he also is, you might say, has a spirit's eye view of what we perceive to be the world. So it's all part of a prearranged plan, but the only way you can be aware of the miracle is just to be willing to be used to extend it. You can't decide in advance how you're going to share it, or to whom, or where. Those are things that are not up to the sleeping mind. All you can do is like put your hand up and say, I'm willing. Use me. And Jesus is like, thank you. I will. and it comes. And it comes. And when you give yourself over to it, it will just come like a stream, and it will come like a river, like a torrent. And as you yield into this function of letting the miracles come through you, you will be taken to the revelatory experience of direct contact with the light that we all are, that we always have been. And then in the second episode, this will be a time when the apostles have been called. Mary Magdala is traveling with the apostles. We'll see in this particular episode, Mother Mary will be there as well. And this will be a time when Jesus is just opening up and making himself available in a very public way for healing. So there are lines of people that hear about Jesus. They hear about the miracles that have already happened, and they line up with all manner of malady, all manner of sickness, of illness, everything from psychic things to, you know, demonic possessions, leprosy, palsy, blindness, and all sorts of ailments. And they just hear about Jesus and the miracles that have happened. But what I think is most helpful about this is this is an early glimpse at the apostles and Mother Mary and Mary Magdala, because you can see that they've all been called by Jesus, and yet their ego is just rearing itself up. You know, they're trying to be friendly, cordial, open with each other, and yet there are these judgments and grievances that have been buried in their mind, and they just start to come up. So while they're trying to learn to be together and live together as a small group that travel with Jesus, there's a lot of ego resistance that is coming up, particularly between Matthew, who has been a tax collector, and Simon is the one who's, Simon Peter is a Jew, and as with many of the Jews, they see a Jewish man that's working for the Romans to collect taxes as like a betrayer, a traitor of the worst kind. And yet Matthew has been called by Jesus. So you have fisherman Simon and his proud Jewish traditions and knowing the scriptures trying to live the best life as a Jew that he can based on his devotion to God. And he's married and he's giving his all for that. And he can get quite angry at times. He has quite a temper. And then there's the very articulate and well-learned Matthew, except his previous profession does not fit very well with Simon at all, or with the group, because there's some in the group that are very sympathetic and open to him, and yet we see a clash. When you start to give your life over to Christ, then the ego will try to use your past against you. Whatever you seem to do, whatever you seem to not do, the ego will try to use it to keep you from running to the light, from lining up with the light. So the ego is ingenious at trying to perpetuate guilt based on what you've done wrong or what you didn't do in the past that you should have done, according to the ego's judgment, where you didn't fulfill the role that was set for you. Of course, the ego set the role to perpetuate the guilt, and of course it loves to just judge and hammer the mind for all the mistakes it's made with the particular role that the ego set up in the first place. So we see the beginnings of what all of us will have to face as well about releasing the past and learning to live in the present moment. And it's very strong, because also it's very striking, as Jesus is spending an entire day, morning, afternoon, and evening with the public. Basically, I think it's, is it Samaria? I forget the location they're in for this, if it's Samaria, or it's one of these places too that in particular Jews are not that welcome. So it's a big stretch to even be there. It's not like home territory where you're welcome. And then to put it out publicly that Jesus is available for healing, and then the lines of people line up. And in that whole context of Jesus pouring his heart out and letting the love of God pour through him, and the context of what seemed to be the bickering and the disagreements and the judgments that are arising in the small group of apostles and friends that are following Jesus. So this shows us, really, it gives us the context for what A Course in Miracles is calling us to. It's calling us to allow up all of our unconscious darkness so that we can hand it over to the Holy Spirit and be defenseless. And Jesus is such a great demonstration of that friendliness, that defenselessness. You'll see it in the first episode, especially with the children. I know for myself, I have been with and worked with children in the earlier part of my parable. It was so much that it just came out of me so easily and so naturally, and I could feel confidence in what was coming through. I could feel confidence. I could feel that the children I was working with were receptive. They weren't judging me. They were grateful. They were actually happy and joyful, and we shared so much glee and happiness together. And I love this episode where we actually get to see that dynamic with Jesus before he goes on his public mission. And then we'll just have to take that same glee and joy and happiness and extend it in a wherever possible, and have to just be very, very prayerful. So I think today will be a very practical day for us. This is a one step and one giant leap. As Neil Armstrong said when he landed on the moon, one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. We are literally taking a journey today with Jesus where we are doing this for the whole universe, because the universe and everything in it is a reflection and in our mind, and it has not left the mind of the thinker. So we need training in miracles. We need training in perceiving in a holistic way, not in a fragmented, separate way. As long as we're looking through the ego's lens and we're perceiving persons and personalities, we're not seeing the big picture. We're not seeing the holistic, forgiven world. We're not seeing the happy dream if we're still judging against people, places, and situations that seem to be external to our mind. Jesus is telling us they are not. You have to pluck the offense from within your mind. You're not going to remove the offense by changing something in the world. And as we closed last night, I thought that was so beautiful, with Christoph saying that here he is, he goes in to meet a client as part of a psychotherapy. He simply reveals that what he had heard from me was, you know, never correct a brother. And the magnificent miracle, the energy that was released from that one idea was life-changing, earth-changing. I mean, it ended the psychotherapy session. It wasn't 50 minutes, it was a few minutes and it was done. And that is a good example of the time collapse, that this doesn't have to be a long, arduous, difficult journey for us at all. This can be quick. In fact, I say the faster the better. Why not? Why not let it be an instant that in which you and the whole universe is healed? Why make it into a long, difficult journey when it can be accomplished in an instant? And it helps to have a way shower demonstrating the presence of the miracle, because that is of enormous help in us starting to take on the function of being a miracle worker. It helps to have role models. It helps to have examples. It helps to have those that inspire you to really let the love inside your heart pour out. And what we're going to see today is a prime example. So for those of you that are on live streaming, I'm glad you joined us. I hope you feel the love and joy that we're having. And for those of you that are obviously in the movie workshop and in the 3-day Life of Mysticism online retreat, we're just getting ready to begin. So enjoy, and I will be back with commentary, and then we'll have a breakout group, and then I'll come back to join you individually at the close.